Decision Tree Pruning refers to a post-processing of a trained decision tree. And we do so for purposes of basically regularization. You may have noticed in the decision tree algorithm, in the ID3 algorithm, just a second, that we do not really have a criterion here that helps us stop early in the construction of the decision tree algorithm. Something which we have seen in the template here as checking for impureness. So this check basically really just checks for purity. It does not tell us, okay, we can stop construction even if we have some impurity left. So this means our decision tree will try to figure out a splitting for as long as the nodes are impure. Of course, if there are contradictions in the example data, then this cannot go further. But if there are no contradictions, we will go as far as possible. And that means the model is complex, and the model will, with some likelihood, overfit to the training data. Here, as a quick recap, what is overfitting? Overfitting with regards to a hypothesis space and a given example set is if we have a hypothesis H from the hypothesis space, whose error is smaller on the train, smaller on the example set that we have, that we are given, then when we calculate the true misclassification rate on the entire feature space. Just as a reminder, true misclassification rate gives us basically an idea, or is supposed to give us an idea, of what the actual classification should be based on the features that we have. So it is very close to the truth. However, very difficult to measure, or somewhat difficult to measure, because we do not have the ideal classifier. We do not have a perfect overview of the feature space. We know where overfitting might come from. We have discussed this before: noisy data, biased data, or lack of size of the data. So in the example that we've seen before, the mushroom example, the size of the data is definitely too small in order to make such an important decision, and we want there to be more. To make this specific, or to estimate whether we are in a situation of overfitting, we use basically two kinds of subsets of our training data. We use a subset for training, and we use a subset for testing, the test data, and those subsets need to be disjunct. So that if we overfit, or if we happen to overfit on the training data, we may notice by applying it to basically unseen data, which emulates the realistic situation of when we are finished training a classifier and then applying it in the real world, and then we see whether it makes actual errors or not. And here is an example also from the Mitchell book where we see such a situation where overfitting takes place for the construction of a decision tree. On the x-axis, we see the size of the decision tree during construction as more and more nodes are added, so more and more the training data is split. And on the y-axis, we see the accuracy, the measured accuracy of the decision tree. And here, for the training data in blue, the curve of improvement of accuracy over the training data, whereas if we check at the same time, after every step of adding a new node to the decision tree, what is the performance of the decision tree on the test data that we held out, then we will see a different characteristic here, a decrease of performance in accuracy. Now, let me skip to here. Let us check the criterion here first. Since we are looking at here the error, and here we measure accuracy, what we must do here is take 1 minus accuracy in order to arrive at the error of the hypothesis. And if we say this is now our hypothesis at this point with 90-something nodes in a decision tree, then we see here that the error is 1 minus the accuracy of 0.85 or something like this. So it is this distance here or this distance to the one value, basically, that is our error. And here we see that with the hypothesis that we have learned at this point, with the 90 odd nodes in the decision tree, the error on the training data is definitely smaller than the error on the of an alternative hypothesis of a, on the that comes from a previous iteration of
in
the
the chat
decision
about
tree.
Terminology, what is an ablation test?
Where was this term?
I think you said it.
No, I didn't actually. I think it's not what is an ablation test, but it's something that we could do. Yes, there are alternative things that we could apply, but I will not go into this right now. I think there are things that other checks that we can do, of course. Yes. So where was I? So we see here the hypothesis that we have trained and the error that we can measure, and the we see here also that so the hypothesis A is the one that comes out of this training procedure, so this decision tree, and the H prime hypothesis would then be, for example, a previous decision tree that we might select here with 50 nodes or something like this. We might select one that is here. And we see here that both inequalities are fulfilled. For example, if this is our H hypothesis and this is our H prime hypothesis, the error on the training data of this hypothesis is smaller. And on the test data, however, the situation is reversed. Here, the error of the hypothesis is higher, the distance to one. Now, what can we do to mitigate this situation? There we also discussed a couple of approaches in the regularization unit. Here as a quick recap, what we could do is we could stop early during the training, or, and this is what I will going to show you last, is we could, after the training, prune the decision tree. So first thing, stopping early. Ideally, we would have stopped somewhere around here when the criterion is not fulfilled. We might consider this also okay because we can expect some loss between training and test data, but somewhere around here would be a good choice to stop training, whereas everything here is not actually worth the effort. And in order to make the decision of stopping, we need the criterion again. So if we go to if we want to go with early stopping, we need some criteria. And here we revisit the splitting criteria that we have also seen previously with the impurity functions of this, with splitting functions. So we might say that we stop continuing the splitting and therefore stop training if the size of a subset that we are currently considering is below a certain threshold. But we need to define this threshold. And there's a problem associated with that, because if we set the threshold too small, we will get very large decision trees again. And if we set the threshold too large, we might miss rather useful splittings, because we then say, okay, here's still 100 examples in there if the threshold is 100, but there are still three or four classes in there. Another perhaps more basic criterion is that of purity of the decision tree. This is basically also what is applied in the ID3 algorithm. If a certain subset that we are currently considering is already pure, then we can stop. Yes, we could continue splitting still. So there might be arguments for continuing to split even if the subset is already pure. However, the default is usually that we stop. However, this given situations where there's a lot of noise in the data, or where it is not that easy to reach a pure decision, we might still end up with a very overly specific decision tree, which results in perhaps even every example ending up in its own class. Oh, it's in its own split or path of the decision tree. And the third criterion we might apply is impurity reduction and see whether a split actually helps us reduce the impurity sufficiently exceeding the threshold, or basically if the impurity reduction is below a threshold, we stop splitting. However, and this then goes back to the exploration of the feature space, what we cannot do is we cannot predict, even if the impurity reduction from this step to this step in the search for a decision tree is small, very small, we cannot predict whether a subsequent impurity reduction might not be high. So we cannot skip ahead. We don't have a look ahead. And there is no way of gaining this foreknowledge other than exploring this feature space more rigorously or more exhaustively. And this is usually not feasible given the explosion of possibilities, given the amount of possible feature values with each decision step that we have. So all of these criteria do not work in practice. And this is why we turn our attention to pruning. And here we apply a very basic principle. We construct a very large decision tree called Tmax. And this is basically the decision tree which would come out of, for example, the ID3 algorithm. We go as far as possible, saying that all the leaf nodes should have splits of the example set which are smaller or equal than 5, or which are pure, or which are only comprised of examples with identical feature vectors, albeit they might be assigned to different classes. So either or any of these criteria might be fulfilled, and then we stop training the decision tree. So we are really overfitting. We are deliberately overfitting. And then in the second step, we take this Tmax tree that we have that is definitely overfitting, and then we start pruning the decision tree again by removing nodes from it, starting at the leaf nodes upwards. The pruning step, or a pruning step, is very basically defined as we start with the decision tree T, we select an inner node, and we remove that node, leaving only that node as a leaf, as a new leaf node, and basically removing the entire subtree. And that then gives us the pruned decision tree, which we designate as T minus TT, where the lowercase t here designates the node over which we have pruned. This is a basic pruning step that we apply. And we do so basically for every inner node of a given decision tree. So this induces an ordering of pruned decision trees that we can get. Yes, there's a question. What will be the new class label of this node? If you go back to the decision tree algorithm, let me see. Here, you see that in the second step, every node, even an inner node, gets assigned a class label. And that is exactly the label that we will then use. It's basically the most common value here that we have in the examples that were in the example split that were considered when constructing the node. So this gets this has already a label. Every inner node has its own label. When applying pruning operations in succession on a decision tree, we can derive variants of the same decision tree. And these variants basically induce a partial ordering, T prime and T here. And we denote this partial ordering with the corresponding symbol. A key point to notice here is that, again, we are not just because we started now doing pruning in a situation where we can then now find in the hypothesis space the ideal decision tree or the smallest decision tree that minimizes the error, simply because we are again doing some form of local optimization in practice. So when we look at the hypothesis space again that we are exploring, This is the exploration for construction. And with pruning, we start at some decision tree. Let's take it, let it be this tree. We prune something and then we jump around in this feature space. We might look at the decision tree that we have seen or explored before, but we might also jump into a different part of the decision tree. And especially if we start here and decide to prune here, then the tree will be a different one than if we decide to prune here, and they may not be easily comparable. So we have a partial ordering only. And that means by making one pruning decision, we will not be able to explore the other path. What would have happened if we made another pruning decision? A second problem that arises is that we cannot be sure that when we decide based on the reduction of error accomplished with the pruning step on the training data, that we will gain an advantage in the test data or with the true misclassification rate. This is the lemma I skipped here. You can read up on this, but we cannot guarantee that. This is why we must do something in addition. We must do validation. So we need in addition, not just a test set to do the final check, but we need also a validation set, which is a subset of the example set. And these all need to be mutually exclusive. We train the T-max tree on the training data set. We use the validation data set for pruning. And then finally, we test on the test set after we are finished with pruning. And then the pruning procedure is pretty straightforward. We start with the T-max, with the, for example, the tree that comes out of the ID3 algorithm. We choose an inner node T in this tree. We perform a tentative pruning based on the pruning operation that we saw, and then compute the reduction in error that we notice based on the validation data set, not the training data set. And if the error is, if we actually notice a reduction in error, so here we don't have a monotonous simulation, not every pruning gives us a reduction error, because of course we might make the decision tree worse than before. We might decide to take the pruning or might decide to leave the pruning based on whether we have an actual reduction. If there's an reduction, we accept the pruning and then we continue with step two with the new tree that we see here, that we have assigned here, until all remaining inner nodes have been also checked, whether they could be pruned. And this way we will get a situation where after the training, we end up with a tree with 90 odd nodes here in this example. And then if we start pruning, we will see an improvement in error on the validation data until we are finished with pruning, ending up with this decision tree in the end, after we have checked all pruning opportunities. And this will then give us on the test data a certain better error. At this point, I would like to conclude the lecture. We are also at the end of the decision tree lecture, and what we have shown you are the very basics of decision trees, how they are constructed, what are the important building blocks, and how can practical decision tree be built. However, there is lots of research on this subject. The entire part is all the basics, but it does not cover many advanced topics in this, and there are many extensions, not only for pruning, but for decision trees in general, that could be applied. So keep this in mind when you apply decision trees in practice. So for example, if you apply a decision tree, you will most likely not use the ID3 algorithm, but use the C4-5 algorithm or the C5 algorithm even, which is much more advanced in various respects. Thank you, everyone. And I would hand over with 20 minutes past the deadline to Benno.
Thank you, Martin. First, can you hear me?
Yes.
Very good. Yeah, I like what you presented. And I also want to say, even if there are other algorithms like the C5 or the count algorithms, the principles are the same. And you have to understand the cross-entropy idea, which we saw with ID3, which also applies in some variant to all other algorithms. You might also have learned or heard about so-called random forests, which are extremely powerful. And these are combinations of decision trees. Decision trees were sometimes underestimated, but they belong to the most powerful tools that we have in machine learning.